We're at a kind of juncture where these technologies are becoming very sophisticated and they can be used to potentially tip the balance too far in favour of innovation and away from consumer protection.
Welcome to this podcast produced by the International Monetary Fund. In this program, the new morality of debt. Haven't lending practices always been immoral to a certain degree?
Yeah, so that's a big question. To begin with, what we consider to be moral lending. Certainly there was a view some centuries ago now that lending per se is immoral because it quite literally indebts a person to another. Obviously, the more recent moral questions relating to debt, to lending, have focused on questions of distributional fairness, which is the sort of problem of women and minorities having poor access to credit is one that has persisted and it's not really been resolved. All right, so I'm Nikita Aggarwal. I'm a researcher based at the University of Oxford. And I research the regulation of new data-driven technologies with a particular interest in AI in consumer finance.
Debt is often seen to be unfair because wealthy lenders can exploit vulnerable borrowers, and recent technological advances in lending have added new dimensions to debt's morality. People's lives online are proving a valuable source of data for lenders, which is fueling concerns about privacy, identity, and dignity. Nikita Aggarwal is a research associate at the Digital Ethics Lab at Oxford. Her article, The New Morality of Debt, is published in the March 2021 issue of Finance and Development magazine. And so what is it about the data that people are willing to share these days that you feel is making the industry perhaps a little more predatory than the traditional banking systems we dealt with before?
Well, so data, the use of more data for lending has multiple effects. So the impact is multifaceted. And in some respects, it could lead to more predatory lending, as you say. But in other ways, it could actually improve access to credit. And one of the phenomena that I'm particularly interested in and have written about is the sort of use of alternative data, so not strictly credit data, but social behavioral data, non-traditional forms of data, to score a consumer's credit worthiness and thereby more easily price their risk and extend credit and potentially offer better terms of credit than they would otherwise have had. And that could actually prevent them from turning to more predatory forms of lending, whether that's payday lending or unregulated forms of lending.
One of the things that you suggest in this article in Finance and Development magazine is that the data is in fact giving the upper hand to a lot of the big tech digital lenders. What type of data is it that they're using to their advantage?
So it's a whole range of data. The premise is that in this society, this data-driven and datafied society that we now live in, everything that we do throws up data. We produce these digital footprints, digital trails, and sort of the insights of various institutions. It started off as startups, fintech startups who are experimenting in this area, but it's sort of become more mainstream in recent years, is that some of these, what are commonly referred to as alternative forms of data, i.e. not strictly credit financial data, can actually provide quite useful insights about a person's propensity to repay debt, so their credit risk and the affordability, which together are sort of components of credit worthiness assessment. And so we're talking about a whole host of things like, what kind of device is the borrower consumer using? Is it Apple or PC? How long do they spend reading the terms and conditions or browsing the website? Do they use capital letters to complete a form? So it's really quite granular.
What is the problem do you see in having access to some of that personal data? I mean, how different is it from what bankers did in the past in terms of, you know, scoping out a person who's applying for a loan, perhaps, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 years ago compared to now?
I think, you know, it could even take you further back than 5 to 10 years. And, you know, if we go way back before the sort of days of more formalized statistical credit scoring, then of course, lending was a much more personal, relational activity that was sort of, and judgments as to credit worthiness were done in a very subjective manner based on, you know, what the banker knows about you. You know, did you go to church on Sunday? Who is your uncle? So on. And that's pretty subjective. It clearly includes a whole host of, you know, formerly non-financial, non-credit data, but it's entirely subjective and it's entirely non-transparent as to what factors went into that decision, right? And so over the course of the sort of latter part of the 20th century, we moved away from that sort of, you know, community relational banking, and we moved to much more formalized, standardized credit scoring processes using statistical methods. And so these sort of informal rules that lenders were using or loan officers were using were formalized. And there were various sort of technical developments, technical advances in computing and, you know, magnetic stripe technology and various things that sort of facilitated and enabled this transition. But particularly it was, in, you know, advances in computing. And so you move from this sort of informal world to sort of more standardized rules-based decision-making. And arguably, those forms of data were more clear. It was more transparent what was being used in some ways. But it had the effect of also excluding certain people because, for example, credit history is typically a highly weighted variable in that credit scoring approach. And if you don't have a, you know, strong credit history, people who are often referred to as thin files or no files, then you don't stand a great chance of either getting access to credit at a you know, a fair price. And so from that world, we've kind of moved into the world of the last 5 to 10 years, where now, again, many more forms of data are being introduced, but in a less kind of maybe arbitrary way. It's sort of introduced into these statistical tools, and there's sort of advances in machine learning and new data science tools that enable these sort of larger, less structured data sets to be analyzed. And so it's sort of, in a weird way, it's sort of different from the immediate past, but maybe not that different from the distant past.
So with all that data now available to lenders, do you see problems in that in terms of privacy and the types of data that they should or should not have access to?
Yes, there's a lot of data available, and you know, the insight of lenders, as I said before, fintech lenders to begin with, and now increasingly what we'd consider more traditional lenders, is that you can mine this data and you can gain valuable insights about a person that, you know, can be used in useful ways. So you can lend to someone who would otherwise have been denied a loan because they didn't have a good credit history, but there are other variables that indicate that they are likely to pay back a loan. Now, this comes with many benefits. There's other aspects to how, you know, what I call algorithmic credit scoring could increase efficiency in consumer credit markets, and it can have fairness gains in terms of access to credit. But there's also this sort of elephant in the room, right, which is, well, this is clearly using a lot of personal data. What does that mean about our privacy? And I think it's you know, it is a real hurdle, and one that's sort of been under theorized, although there is attention and concern around it. And I think, you know, there are, again, many dimensions to the privacy problem. Privacy means many different things in different contexts, but there's this basic fundamental idea that, well, you know, and perhaps it's a slightly more European notion that individuals should have the ability to control the use of their data, and that this is sort of essential to our right to self-determination and our autonomy. And so to the extent that all the data that we're producing in this datafied society that we live in is being used in ways that we don't fully have control over and to make decisions about us, not least relating to our ability to access credit that we can't control, then we're losing our autonomy, we're losing control over our information and therefore ourselves. That's one way of looking at it. But there's also another way of looking at it, which is that sort of you could think of privacy or the right to privacy and the rights to data protection as being instrumental and as necessary to prevent more tangible harms like the misuse of information through maybe identity theft or the use of information to discriminate against us whether that's on, you know, racial or gender grounds, or, you know, lenders who are simply exploiting vulnerable consumers who have lower financial literacy and wouldn't necessarily be able to understand the terms of a not so favorable credit product and wouldn't shop around for a better one. And that happens a lot.
Yeah. And so, you know, the argument that you make in this article is about striking the right balance between the benefits and the harms of datafied lending. And you've published research in the Cambridge Law Journal laying out some of the regulatory reforms that you suggest should happen in order to do that. But how do you introduce more regulation to this industry without stifling the innovation that's emerging from it?
Yes, great question. So I think this sort of a starting observation, which is that, as you know, the financial sector, the financial industry is one of the most regulated sectors of the economy. And I think it's important to appreciate that there is already a lot of regulation and useful regulation that we can build off. So it's not a case of reinventing the wheel. And likewise, at least in Europe and in the UK, which are the jurisdictions that I'm based in and that I write most about, there's also quite a developed and sophisticated body of data protection law and privacy law that have already had to think about these questions that you point to of balancing consumer protection with encouraging innovation and, you know, in the EU's case, sort of this internal market. And so I argue that the tools are already in place, that the challenge and the sort of requirement now is to rebalance a little bit our goals, our priorities. And so we've encouraged technological progress. We've facilitated the growth of many new technologies, data-driven technologies. But we're at a kind of juncture where these technologies are becoming very sophisticated and they can be used to potentially tip the balance too far in favor of innovation and away from consumer protection. And we need to shift the dial slightly more in the direction of consumer protection, thinking particularly about the privacy and fairness risks of these technologies. And you know, the new proposal from the European Commission to regulate AI, what they're calling the AI Act, is really an attempt to do that. You could argue it goes too far, but it's trying to say, well, you know, there are certain uses of this technology, uses of data and in AI systems that are inherently high risk, and we need to put sort of guardrails around them now.
And so why are the most advanced economies in the world, like the UK and the US, falling short when it comes to trying to regulate this industry?
I'm not sure that they're falling short. You know, it's... Well, going back to your question, there's this sort of perennial dilemma, right, of choosing between or sort of balancing innovation and protection. And there's two parts to this. One is sort of the awareness of the problems, which sort of typically take some time to catch up. Maybe those in academia and those in specialized NGOs have raised alarms early on, but it takes time for that information sort of to trickle down and to sort of really influence the policy debate and the sort of political process. And so that's, I think, what we're seeing now, that, you know, it's now been at least 5-6 years since the sort of conversation around data ethics and digital ethics really started to become more prominent. And it takes time for the awareness of the problems to be articulated first and then to sort of travel and translate into policy. And even, you know, the adoption of this act or in whatever form it eventually takes is still some years away. But there's also the kind of political economy of it, which is that clearly these technologies are big drivers of economic growth, and the companies, not just the technologies in isolation or in the abstract, but the companies that are benefiting or that are growing off the back of them are some of the largest companies and most profitable companies, certainly in the US and Europe. And so, you know, over-regulating would seem to be a sort of own goal.
So one might argue, I mean, you do say that consumers, it's very difficult for consumers to protect their own privacy, given the extent to which people are online. But one might argue that consumers can actually safeguard their own privacy by choosing not to be active online. Is that realistic?
I don't believe that it is. I don't think you can go off the grid in today's society unless you basically want to cut yourself off from society. And that might be a choice that you make, and certainly people are making that choice. But for most people, in order to survive, in order to thrive, they need to be connected. They need to use the internet. They need to probably also share their data and access services like, you know, credit, or whether it's, you know, renting in a property or getting a job. These are all data driven, and they're all sort of essential for most people.
So do you believe that digital lending practices can ultimately help shed some of the discrimination within the traditional system and make more people want to apply for credit online?
Yeah, so digital lending, in a sort of broader sense, encapsulates many things, and certainly, you know, the move to more digital online lending has enabled access to credit for many people who would otherwise have been sort of restricted from accessing credit due to their physical location, because they're not near a bank branch and so on. It's also, you know, the use of digital technologies, the use of sort of to automate many processes in lending have also, in some cases, reduced the cost of lending and made it more convenient. The fact that we can take out a loan, or, you know, manage your finances, get financial advice and so on, all through an app on your phone, significantly increases the convenience and sort of reduces a lot of the friction that may have otherwise stopped people from getting that kind of advice. And so certainly there's a lot of potential and hope and benefits from digital technology as applied to lending and consumer credit markets. The question really is whether the regulatory framework can be designed in a way to capture those benefits whilst also mitigating some of these potential harms, you know, that so where lenders don't use those data insights to, you know, pass on cost savings to consumers, but instead exploit vulnerable consumers by targeting them with really not so good credit offers at times of vulnerability and so on. And I think that the, you know, regulation plays a very important role here, as it does in sort of any part of the economy. I think, you know, really a large part of the solution is making sure that data processors, in this case digital lenders, have the right duties of care in place to act in the best interests of their customers.
Nikita Aggarwal, Research Associate at the Digital Ethics Lab at Oxford University's Internet Institute. Thanks so much.
Thanks so much, Bruce. Really great chatting to you.
You can read Nikita Aggarwal's article on the new morality of debt in the March 2021 issue of Finance and Development magazine. Read it online at imf.org/FND or download the Finance and Development app. And look for other IMF podcasts wherever you get your podcasts. You can also follow us on Twitter at IMF_podcast. I'm Bruce Edwards. Thanks for listening.